prominent Atlanta attorney charged with involuntary manslaughter in the death of his wife back in court today. Prosecutors are fighting to have Tex McIver's bond revoked. They say that investigators found a gun during a search of his condo, and under the conditions of his bond, McIver was not allowed to carry any weapons. Joining me right now to weigh in on all of this, criminal defense attorney Lauren Zimmerman, a man that we have had here many times. We always appreciate your insight.
Thank you.
Give me a sense of this. Does not being allowed to carry any weapons mean that he could not have even one in his home, even if it wasn't his, correct?
Yeah, as a condition of bond, he's not supposed to have any firearms at all, and anything in his home is presumed to be his. So that is, if they could prove it, that is a violation of his bond. The question now becomes, did he know it was there?
But if it is his wife's weapon, if it is her weapon, then is he off the hook on this? Is that any kind of defense in the matter?
I mean, look, if he had lots of firearms, had 40 or 50 firearms in his home, and he did everything he could, and he thought he got rid of them all, and he by mistake, and they could show he mistakenly left something in a sock drawer that hadn't been in a while, then they could give him an out. But the problem is, because it's his sock drawer that presumably he's been going to for a few months, and there's a gun there, I mean, that's a problem.
See,
for him.
I got to tell you, I'm not a judge, I'm not an attorney, but this has way too many moving parts to it. According to the law, as I read it, now tell me if I'm wrong or right about this, if you have a weapon in your place of residence and you're out on bond, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Except his lawyers are trying to raise the fact, and was watching the video before, that he did not know or somebody placed it in that drawer. So if somebody put it there and he didn't know about it, he has to have knowledge. So if they can't show he had knowledge about it, or someone else had access to the house through that drawer, then that gives him an out.
So the normal procedure then, if somebody violates their bond, is to go back to jail.
But he doesn't violate his bond if he didn't know that it was there or someone else put it there. I mean, in essence, yes, there's something in his home, it's presumed, but under the law, they have to show by preponderance of the evidence that he knew that weapon was in the drawer.
But again, if you're out on bond and this is where you live and you live there alone, then you are responsible for those things that are in your place of residence.
You are, but Jeff, somebody slipped into his house and stuck a gun in his drawer, which
but
sounds
then that
like...
But that plays conspiracies, does it not?
Well, I think his lawyer's almost raising that. I think they were questioning Mr. Corey or about who may have put something in his drawer. His assistant was accused of doing that today.
Right. So every step of the way in this prosecution will involve this sort of two steps forward, one step back.
Well, look, when you are charged with a crime, there's a presumption of innocence, and the burden is always on the state to prove in the trial guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. The bond revocation, the burden's a little bit different. But they have to prove their case, and that is what, as the Constitution, that is why we try cases, that the facts can be laid out before a jury to make the decision. But this is for Judge McBurney, who's a great judge, and he's taking his time. This lasted longer than most bond revocations ever last.
So how long will this go, then, if he's taking his time?
It may go to a third day, it looks like, and the judge is asking a lot of pointed questions. He asked questions about, to Mr. Corey, whether he knew or who someone placed it in that drawer.
When you look at this case, there seems to be so much that's ambiguous, that the prosecution has decided to go after him full bore on all of this. Very difficult to prove substantially, yes?
The case in chief, I mean, you know, it depends. His first statement to the media wasn't great when he talked about he was worried and he was in a bad area and he had his gun out and he fumbled it and then it went off. So then it changed. But sounds like he passed a polygraph, which isn't admissible in court, but the district attorney's office is trying to search for other things that have been going through his life, trying to figure out why would he kill his wife? What's the motive? Did he need the money? I heard today that there may have been a second will that they were talking about.
Yeah.
They haven't uncovered any of this.
Again, back to that whole issue of moving parts on this. It's a fascinating case. It's going to go on a long time. Lauren Zimmerman, thank you. We appreciate it. We will be back here undoubtedly quite often.
Sounds good.
All right, thanks. Sheba?